back with another exciting episode of Rick's Horror Review Show. That's Rick's Rated R Horror Documentary Review, where we review all things that are related to horror. Horror movies, horror TV shows, horror documentaries, horror wrestling gimmicks, horror primetime specials from the 1990s featuring Barbara Walters. And I'm Hill Down, because around here we absolutely love that shit. But if I am honest with you, and I am always honest with you, there is one horror that I tend to gravitate towards more than others. And that horror that has to deal with the Catholic Church and demonic possession. I just love that shit. I love those stories. But I also love horror that deals with vampires, so it happens to be. I love what we do in the shadows. If you haven't heard that review, you should go check it out. But I also love a good zombie movie. And slow walking zombies. And of course, the classic ghost in your home. It's haunting you because fuck it. Ain't nothing you can do. And it doesn't want to leave. That's his house. Welcome to our show. If you are new. If you are a returning listener, welcome back. We love having you here. And before my producers start barking in my ears, I'd like to remind you to be our friend on the old socials, on the TikToks, on the Instagram, on the Facebooks, and of course on our YouTube channel as Lestic Holt. I say, Mr. Holt. You can follow Rick on his YouTube channel at Rick's Horror. If you haven't seen any of the stuff we put on there, it's different than this. Typically like a preview, maybe like an interview, and I'm doing things with my hand again. If you're only listening, you're totally missing out on all these hand gestures. That's too bad. Before we go on, let's first and foremost introduce the co-host, official co-host of Rick's Horror Review Show, Billy the AI!
I'm here. Let's get back to the future, Marty. Something's gotta be done about your kids, the fuck-ups. And let's get it done. Let's get this review on the road.
Roads, Billy. Where we're going, we don't need roads.
Okay, here we go. Yeah, take one of these.
Okay, appreciate that. Are you ready to review tonight's episode? It's a little different. And by the way, if you're just tuning in tonight, Oh my God, let me get that special one. It's always special.
Tonight is a very special episode because we're continuing our series of... Well, why don't we just jump right into it?
What do you say, Billy? Ready?
I'm ready. Let's get it done.
Let's get it done indeed! If you are new to this show, we have a simple format that we'd like to adhere to, and that's how this episode's going to go. I am going to talk about why this documentary, that's right, it's not a horror film, it's a documentary tonight. And because this is a documentary, I'll tell you what kind of horror documentary this is. Then I'll tell you whether or not I endorse this documentary. I'll give it a rating, and I'll give you a ton of context. And then we'll get into some real illogical stuff. Because it's real horror in this documentary. There are some things on here that are sensitive in nature, but not as... we're not going to take some super comedic approach to this, but there's certainly some stuff that you can't help but, unfortunately, see it from a comedic perspective. Okay. So why this documentary? And by the way, if I haven't mentioned this already, it's called Abducted in Plain Sight. You can find this on Netflix. Yes, it's available now. I think it came out in 2017. And, you know, we had a couple of weeks where we were just kind of not reviewing anything of interest. And I decided that maybe I should use a different method of choosing things. And so guess what? I started reading descriptions.
I know that you don't read them because you don't want to spoil yourself, but you can't just just the book but the old cupboard. You know what I mean? Gotta find out a little bit at least. I mean, you're right, and definitely, I think it's definitely been, I definitely think it's been helpful. Yes, it is helpful to, at the very least, read the description, and thankfully, and you know what really grinds my gears? When Netflix just goes into its preview, and then you don't know that it's actually not just a preview anymore. You're actually starting to watch the whole damn thing without your knowledge, and I'm like, hey, hold on a second, I don't know if I want to commit to this yet. But anyway. This documentary is called Abducted in Plain Sight and is available now on the old Netflix. All right, so moving on. Why this documentary? Do I endorse it? I'll give you, you know, the other one we did in terms of the Society of the Now. I skipped a lot of the things that are typical of the show, endorsement and rating. But you know what? I felt like they are already profiting from this. I'm not being insensitive by talking about these things. It's entertainment, whether you like it or not. It's a story that somebody got paid for. If it's out there and someone's profiting from it, I think it's fair game. Hell, we're just talking about it here and now. Okay, so we won't have such a serious tone, although it's somewhat of a serious... Well, not somewhat of a serious, it's relatively serious. Not relatively serious, it's legitimately serious shit. We're gonna see. When this baby hit 38 miles per hour. When this baby hit 38 miles per hour. You're gonna see such serious shit, Marty. Alright, so let's begin. And as you notice, the only thing that is absent from tonight's show, well, one of the things that is absent from tonight's show, is four fun film facts with Billy the AI. Because there's nothing fun about the shit that we're about to talk about. Again, this is a documentary. Really? I agree. I didn't think that, you know, fun film facts with Billy the AI would be appropriate for this episode. Even though, like you just said, it's still entertainment. It's already out there. But I don't like it. I don't want to have four fun film facts with Billy the AI either. So, Billy, sit back, relax, and enjoy the show. Yeah, I'll just be here if you need me, and, you know, let's get it done. Let's get it done, Billy. All right, let's continue. So why this movie? Why this film? Why this documentary? As I said, we had some weeks where we just kept picking really uninteresting stuff. And I started reading descriptions, and I saw this description for this documentary. How does my mic sound over here? Oh, I sound muffled. Hello? Can you hear me? Hello, sir? I know you're in there. Huh? Oh, no, no one's home. Sir, I can hear you from the other side of the door. Just open the door, sir. No, no blink glass. I can hear you talking to somebody in English, sir. I know you speak English. I can't hear you. I know you can hear me, because I can hear you. Just open the door. I swear I'm not selling Bibles. I'm not opening the door. Whatever, fuck you.
Oh, jeez.
What kind of documentary is this? What kind of genre? What kind of horror genre is this? People like to call this true crime. I like to call this real life horror. This is real life horror. This happened in real life, and it's horrific. And I'm going to go right into a rating here, okay? And because we have a lot of context, and we have a lot of illogical shit to review. And we'll know who. I don't know how long we're going to go, but we're going to go as long as we need to go. I'm going to give this documentary a 7 out of 10. It is well done. I'm not talking about the content itself. I am talking about the way in which it was presented to you. You know, in terms of, like, storytelling, really. You're going to have bad documentaries, too, where it feels like they're skewed one side or the other. I definitely felt like this was presented in a factual and well-researched way. So, yes, it was a well-done documentary. That's how we're going to attack these from now on. So, a 7 out of 10 in terms of the rating for this documentary. Okay. Was this entertaining? Yes, this was entertaining. As much as you want to sit there and scream at the television and yell at the people that these real people for the situations that they place themselves in, you're glued to the dang television or the telly or the computer screen or the telly or the phone. You're glued to it. Because it is impossible to believe that this is actually what happened. That this is not some, you know, fictional horror story. That this is actual, real-life horror. So was this entertaining? Absolutely. It was extremely entertaining. Yes, I endorse this. I'm talking about it tonight. I always recommend you go watch this stuff. But I officially tell you tonight, right here, one night only, go watch this documentary. As a matter of fact, they've also turned this story into a Peacock TV show. So it's definitely, the story is definitely worth a look. And that's why we're talking about it tonight. Okay, so that's enough of that. Let's get into the context. Abducted in Plain Sight, if you don't know, is about an abduction. Okay, the title gives that away. But there's more to meet than meets the eye in this abduction. It's not a typical case of abduction where, unfortunately, these situations happen. Kid gets taken because of, the nefarious people that do these kind of shit, these kind of things, or, you know, whatever the reason is. It's different than that. And let's get into it, the context. Here's a little bit of background about the characters. Well, they're not characters. These are real-life people. I keep saying characters, but real-life people in a real-life horror story. If you're just joining us, this is Rick's Horror Review Show, and tonight we're reviewing Abducted in Plain Sight, a real-life horror story that actually happened. So we are going to talk about Jan, but I'm going to give you a little bit of background. Now, Jan is the kid that was actually abducted, but the documentary did a good job of telling her story, and as usual, as was with the Society of the Snow, there's just things that jump into my brain that I want to know more about, and all this information that is, this background stuff, most of this stuff is covered. There are some questions that lingered in my head when I'm yelling at the TV screen, how can this be? How come no one did anything about this? A lot of that stuff is me, or a lot of stuff that you find here is me essentially answering my own questions from when that happened, okay? It's not every single one, simply because it's too raw. I just saw this, and it's just it's still unbelievable that this thing actually happened. But anyway, let's move on. Okay, so Jan is the character of the girl, not a character, a real person who was actually abducted. They featured in this documentary her parents, Bob and Mary and Brober, quite a bit. They were central figures in her life and obviously in the story in this documentary. They were active members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, which is abbreviated as LDS Church. I had no idea. And the church, as you can imagine, and this takes place in the 1970s, played a significant role in their community and family life. I can't tell you what it was like to live in a religious community in the 1970s, but it certainly sounds like, you know, they felt like they were, it's quote-unquote, as Bob says, we could leave a door open without worrying about anything. I don't necessarily know what that means. I've never lived in a community where I can feel comfortable to leave my doors open or leave the doors unlocked. I hope it certainly wasn't some dog whistle for, we're keeping all the brown and white people, all the brown and black people up. But maybe they just felt secure because they're, I don't know. But anyway, he said this. You can look at the documentary. I don't know what it means. That's just what it means to me. Maybe it wasn't a dog whistle. In any case, Jan had a religious upbringing. She grew up in a Mormon family in Pocatello, Idaho. And she was raised, as I just said, in the Church of Latter-day Saints in a conservative and extremely religious environment. Maybe this is the reason why they felt safe leaving the doors unlocked, but clearly leaving your door unlocked is not a good idea. So they thought. So anyway, the upbringing emphasized family values, I guess, trust in the community, and a strong sense of faith. The only thing that I think a community, the only thing that I think is different from somebody who's religious and some not religious is maybe a strong sense of faith. I didn't grow up in a community like this, and I don't necessarily agree that this is the only place where you can find family values or trust in your community or have faith, but hey, whatever. That's just what they said. That's how they said they grew up in the 70s. So Jan Broberg had a couple of siblings, and their family life was, you know, as was told in the documentary, close-knit and loving, which is a good thing. Congratulations for having a close-knit family. This dynamic was typical, I guess, of what you'd find in, you know, a 1970s religious family with a focus on togetherness and community involvement, and congratulations. Her early life, Jan was born in Pocatello, Idaho, and on July 31st, 1961. And as I just mentioned, she grew up in a close-knit community that was very religious, and she was involved in community activities, which included acting and singing. Again, let's not forget, this is the real person who's still alive today. Unfortunately, Jan was the victim of kidnapping events. This thing is called Abducted in Plain Sight. What do you expect? So she was the victim of a couple of them. That's right, you heard right. Two kidnappings. Now let's get into the first one. Just a little bit of context. The first one happened, and I'm telling you the story, and a lot of the stuff is from the documentary, but I want to paint the picture here, because this isn't the meat of the shit that was making me angry about this goddamn horror story. So the first kidnapping occurred to her at the age of 12 in 1974. She was abducted by a family friend, and his name was Robert Birchtold, or B. They called him B. Why the fuck do you call somebody B? I don't... So he was a neighbor, this B, Birchtold. He was a neighbor and close friend to the Broberg family. What does that say? This is the guy who went to the same church that they did. This is the guy who had community events with this family. This is the guy who, according to the documentary, came and had sleepovers with this girl in her room. And then the girl had sleepovers. I mean, this is just a wild fucking story, and you can get into the meat of that particular story. I'm only giving you a little bit of background, because the meat of the story is that this woman was kidnapped. Why or how is really part of the documentary, and I don't want to spoil too much of it. I think you should really, really watch this. I mentioned I endorse this, but anyway. Kidnapped in 1974 at the age of 12 by Birchtold B. He was obsessed with this girl, so clearly this idiot was a pedophile, right? This fucking moron. And, it's not clear exactly when he developed this really unhealthy relationship or really unhealthy obsession with Jan, but the documentary even has recordings. The documentary opens up with a recording of Bob Birchtold talking about the girl. Like, he recorded himself saying these things, and it's just, you know, talk about fucking horror. That's a fucking horror character right there. And anyway, he kidnaps this girl under the guise that he's going to take her horseback riding to Mexico. Which, by the way, okay, and this is where it starts to get, I don't want to say a lot of the meat of the story, but this is where it just begins right here. Who in the hell thinks it's okay for a 38-year-old man to take a 12-year-old girl horseback riding without her parents? Oh, well, you have the benefit of hindsight. The 70s were a different time. I'm sorry, but the 70s were not that long ago, okay? I don't care what fucking community you grew up in. That's just not normal. And it's not just this instance of Bob coming over and taking this girl horseback riding, as I just mentioned. That's probably the least of the nefarious reasons or the least of the nefarious activities that this guy engaged in with this girl. Coming over, calling her his beauty, holding her, laying in her bed, making her part of her therapy. I mean, this shit is just fucking horrific, let me tell you, all right? I don't want to get all into it, because you can really Again, the documentary did a good job. You should really watch that. But anyway, just the meat here. Or rather, just the bones here. So during that first kidnapping, he takes her. You know, he pretends like he's going to take her horseback, right? And by the way, let me make this very clear. The mother agreed to let the little girl go horseback riding, by the way. Okay? It's not like he came in and, like, taped her up and then took her without the parents' permission and immediately the parents would be concerned. No. The mother let the kid, the 12-year-old child, leave with this man. You could say, hey, everybody makes mistakes. The 70s were a different time. I am sorry. I disagree. Respectfully. So anyway, he goes to Mexico. And during this event or this time, he Burchtold manipulates Jan into believing that they were part of some alien mission and that she needed to have a child with him to save some alien planet. I don't want to say gullible for a 12-year-old, and maybe this is one of those things where, yeah, the amount of maturity that a 12-year-old had back then is not the same that it is now. So I don't blame Jan. She was a child. I definitely place all of the blame on her parents. But my goodness, she was sold this idea that somehow or some way or some reason she needed to be the savior of some alien race. And this says two things to me. Jan was, really, really, how do I describe this? A child, in the best words that I can say. And Bob was more than just a pedophile and a kidnapper and a serial rapist. He's making up all these things and the theatrics that he went to is just like sickening. A level of sickening that I have not heard of. It's just fucking insane. And we continue. So he takes her to Mexico. He's supposed to have a child with him to save some alien planet. And this is not where Bob's, I think necessarily psychological manipulation with Jan began, but it certainly led, unfortunately, Jan to develop a really unhealthy and unnatural attachment and trust in Burchtold, unfortunately. You can imagine, again, a 12-year-old child who knows no better. He marries her in Mexico. Because in Mexico, marrying a fucking 12-year-old was legal in the 1970s as well. Fucking Mexico. So he marries her in Mexico, right? So not only is she kidnapped, by the way, again, as I just mentioned, parents allow her to get taken. She's allowed to be taken to Mexico. She's drugged. She's raped. And she's forced to marry. The 12-year-old who trusts this adult willingly married this guy, but really it was forced. Thankfully, because the parents had at least some sense that to allow the FBI to be involved, the FBI located them in Mexico, and Jan was thankfully returned to her family. She's alive, certainly psychologically scarred, traumatized, and you can imagine a whole host of mental issues that could have arisen and probably did arise from such an experience, but at the very least, she's back home with her family, you know? So Jan believed that she was in love with Burchtold. Now imagine all this manipulation that she's going through. Again, this is just fucking insane. Like real life horror shit. She believes that she's in love with Burchtold, and she believed, and this is from her own words, this is a documentary, she believed that the alien mission was a real thing. Okay? This is not something that that Burchtold is communicating or that the parents are communicating. This is coming from her own mouth in the documentary. She believed that this stuff was real. Unfortunately, this isn't the end of the kidnapping situation. 2 years later, in 1976, Burchtold kidnaps this girl again. And this time, he takes her further away. Well, I don't say further away, but he takes her to a Catholic school in California, in Pasadena, where he enrolls her as a student under a false name, of course, and where he pretends to be the girl's father. And he kept her hidden from her family for months. And this entire time, this asshole is still communicating with the family. and you know, and saying all kinds of weird shit, like, oh, Jen has contacted me, pretending, calling the mother and calling the father and pretending like he didn't know where she was. I mean, the level of fucking crazy is just insane. You know, I talk about, like, a fucking horror character. This guy just epitomizes all of that shit, for real. It's just insane to think about, okay? Thankfully, even though it happened months after, Jan was rescued by authorities. My God. Thank God. I want to get into now the issues with the legal proceedings and the impact, okay? Because he faced several legal consequences, as you should, for kidnapping a kid. Not just once, but fucking twice. Kidnapping, raping, you can imagine every crime that can ever be committed against the child, this asshole was committing them. So he faced legal consequences for his actions, but the penalties that this guy received, considering the severity of all this horrific shit that he was doing, was ridiculous. I mean, I could not, I'm looking at this documentary, the film, and I just, all the horrors that is fucking happening, and I'm just thinking to myself, how can, first and foremost, how can he be even allowed out after the first kidnapping? Okay, and I'll get into a little bit of the reason why he got a, you know, relatively light sentence the first time around. But considering the severity of these crimes, the leniency that this guy got, and of course, this is the part that I don't understand. The Brovers family had a reluctance in pressing charges, and that influenced their own manipulation. Rather, they were, I mean, I'm so worked up. They did not want to press charges on Bob for the first kidnapping. And you know why? Because he had some, frankly, relatively light blackmail. Like, I cannot fathom the idea that under any circumstances of blackmail, that you would put your own personal status in your fucking religious fucking community or with your religious fucking peers. Who gives a flying fuck about your religious fucking community, about the fucking community that you live in? Who gives a flying fuck? I am sorry. Well, the 70s were a different time. I don't give a flying fuck. And this hasn't been one of those episodes where we haven't cursed a lot in recent times, but the level of horror here, shit is ridiculous. Instead of pressing charges, they sign an affidavit, or they sign away the, you know, the rights to be able to press charges. They decide not to press charges, and he gets away scot-free. I think he does 45 days in jail. The blackmail events that occurred, maybe I'll get into a little bit of later, but I don't want to say them because to me, it doesn't matter. You know, your child's well-being versus you being blackmailed. And by the way, the blackmail itself wouldn't have landed either one of them in, even if it did is the thing, even if it landed one of them or two of them in some sort of legal trouble or legal consequences, it's your fucking child. It's your job. Your job is to protect your goddamn child. It doesn't matter, like The Rock would say. It doesn't matter what the legal consequences would have been. There were never going to be any legal consequences to them had they pressed charges. The only thing that would have been an issue for them was their community's debt. Aww. But the church, what will they think of me? That's the reason why they decided not to press charges the first time around. My goodness. So anyway, this guy gets off with a, you know, super light sentence. Now, obviously, if you can imagine, the family was, in fact, impacted. At some point, I guess it finally dawned in their head that somehow they were being manipulated by, you know, by Birchtel. The entire family was being manipulated. And they struggled to come to terms with the betrayal and the psychological, in fact, psychological damages inflicted on John. I don't know how I can't process this. It's not just hindsight. I just can't think of it. Like, if it's happening, what really grinds my gears. This one was really worked me up. But the fact that this happened, not once, you know, I get it. Okay, maybe you feel guilty about the first one. You made a stupid fucking mistake as a parent. You know, everybody makes mistakes. I get it. But Jesus Christ, the fact that you fucking allowed it to happen again, my goodness. The fact that you don't realize that somebody's manipulating you, like, I told myself, well, I don't really feel like insulting these people for being dense. But, you know, I can't help but think about the level of density, not destiny, but the level of density that someone must have in order to allow this situation to happen. Not once, but twice. Once I understand, you know, you're busy with fucking work, trying to, you know, put food on the table, and you have some rebellious child who doesn't come home because she's doing something that she shouldn't be doing, and unfortunately, some tragic situation happens. I get that shit. You can't be blamed for doing everything that you can to make sure that your family is taken care of. And unfortunately, in those situations, what could you do? You probably would blame yourself, right? But the fact that the first time around, the kid wasn't taken per se. She was allowed to leave. She just wasn't brought back. And she was allowed to leave with somebody that had an unhealthy relationship with your child before you were allowed that child to be taken. It didn't happen after you allowed that child to be taken. It happened before, because this child was groomed and you allowed yourself as an adult, because of the level of density that is in your head, not destiny, the level of density. You are my density, Lorraine McFly. The level of density in these two characters is beyond my comprehension. I'm sorry. Anyway, thankfully, Jan was relatively okay. I don't know, right? But, you know, she seems like she is collected mentally, physically. She seems to be healthy and doing well. She's 62 years old by now. And in later in life, you know, she had a career in acting and actually has appeared in various films and TV shows. But more importantly, she's also an advocate. She became an advocate for victims of child abduction and sexual abuse, and she speaks publicly about her experiences to raise awareness and help prevent similar incidents from happening to others. I read a lot about, like, what the mental state of mind in the 70s was about child abduction. And, you know, it feels like, to me, it's not that long ago. 50 years ago, it's not that long ago. Did we not put our child's safety or our children's safety first then? That's just like, I can't process it. It just doesn't, I can't register it. Yes, communication methods were not the same. Today you can reach anybody with a cell phone. Everybody has an AirTag. Everybody's immediately available and you know exactly where everybody is and at all times. But it's just that it didn't happen somewhere else. It happened inside your home. You allowed this character in your home. You allowed your child to be manipulated. You allowed yourself to be manipulated. And it's just so difficult for me to swallow the level of density that you need to have. Anyway, as I just said, obviously the documentary that talks about her story, Abducted Inside, is what we're talking about tonight. And that was released in 2017. And it details, obviously, all the kidnapping and psychological manipulation she endured. And really provided a really disturbing look at the power of grooming and manipulation by a trusted family friend. The sad reality is that I can understand a child being manipulated, but as an adult, the level of manipulation and grooming on the adults to me is baffling, to be honest with you. But anyway, that story is a harrowing reminder of obviously all the dangers of child abduction and the complex psychological impact of grooming and manipulation they can have on children. But to me, an eye-opening situation in terms of how adults, also groomed and manipulated to me is insane. Thankfully, as I just said, did a tremendous work in advocacy and raising awareness about child safety and sexual abuse, sexual abuse prevention. And this is now, I think, part of her legacy more than anything else, is this is the one that thing. Okay, so now, to me, the illogical stuff about this stuff. Okay, I'm going to sound repetitive, but I got to talk about this again. So Birds told abducted Jan in 1974, again, took her to Mexico. He marries her in Mexico. The legal age of marriage in Mexico, 12 years old. Mexico. Seriously? Insane. The marriage was part of his delusional plan and manipulation about the aliens and needing to have sex with the child in order to save the alien planet. This is all from his mind. The sick and twisted shit that this guy told these, you know, like, I don't know if this was just to tell himself to believe that this was okay, but to also tell somebody else, somebody, you know, young and impressionable this. And also, what I really want to talk about in terms of the illogical here is the legal consequences. Again, you know, one, they returned to the United States the first time around. And the FBI agent, by the way, I am not the only one who is up in arms about this stuff. The FBI agent in the documentary, you need to watch this documentary. Again, this is endorsed. Go watch the documentary. Real life horror. As good as it gets.
Hey, Rick. Isn't this called true crime?
No, this is called real life horror, damn it. Not true crime. It's some other show. So the FBI agent is very much... I was with the FBI agent. The FBI agent, by the way, in the documentary, is the only person that I can look to and sounds sane. I'm sorry. Towards the later, when Jan is talking about her advocacy work, it's very clear that, you know, she is definitely in a much better situation than she was then, yeah, as you can imagine. When they come back, or when they're brought back to the United States from that first kidnapping, somehow, Birchtold is allowed to strike a plea deal. How does this happen? Again, the 70s were not that long ago. How does this guy, he kidnapped the child. How isn't the state responsible or you know, the state of Idaho, why isn't the federal government responsible for pressing charges on behalf of the child? Why isn't this a thing then? Why isn't this a thing since the creation of laws in this country? So he's allowed to strike a plea bargain, and of course he pleads guilty to a lesser charge that's not kidnapping, and results is a minimal sentence. And get this, and I said this already, maybe you missed it. But he gets 45 days for kidnapping a child. And by the way, that is the only charge he receives. He doesn't receive a charge of rape. He doesn't receive a charge of, unlawful wedding somebody. I know it's in a different country, but he doesn't receive a charge for, you know, mental manipulation. If there is such a thing, I hope there is such a thing. He receives a kidnapping charge and gets less than 45 days in jail for the first kidnapping. How does this happen in this fucking country? Who wants to go back to this nonsense? This shit sounds horrific. This is fucking horror at the highest, the nth degree. Look at the math back there. That's the kind of horror that this shit is. This is real. This shit happened. 45 days. Now, what contributed to this leniency is insane to me. The fact that you could even consider anything, the fact that you could consider leniency under any circumstances, okay, at all. As I said earlier, Bob and Mary, her parents, were hesitant to press charges against Bridgetold because of threats of exposing personal secrets about them that could have ruined them and the standing in their community. And I'm going to ruin shit for you right now, okay? You should really watch this, but I don't know. Should I ruin it? Should I ruin it? Should I not ruin it? Should I not ruin it? You know what? We're going to... I want you to watch it. I'm not going to ruin it. But it is insane. This is the only reason why they didn't press charges. Their life wasn't in danger. They never would have faced legal consequences. Nothing. Literally nothing. Some delusion that they had in their head about what would potentially happen to them in their community is the reason why they decided not to press charges. Oh, God damn it. Ah! The legal and social context of the 1970s, I guess, is now used as an excuse, right? It played a role. There was less awareness and harshness in sentences regarding child abduction and child sex abuse. I don't know why. What was wrong with people in the 70s? I don't get it. But anyway, move on to the next one. It gets even more illogical, okay? She gets taken the second time around in 1976. Despite that first traumatic kidnapping, somehow, this is more illogical, somehow, Bridgetold continues to communicate with the family. Who does that? This guy's ripped your daughter. Why do you have communicate? This guy should have a restraining order against him. He should be forced to register as a sex offender. And maybe there was no sex offender registry in those days. I get that. But definitely restraining orders were around. How could you allow somebody? And even if they weren't allowed, this is America. You know what I'm talking about? We have the most guns in the history of the country, and they're mostly used for the dumbest of shit. But you want to talk about actually having a gun to protect your family? I can't think of a better reason. Keep them at arm's length. Stay out of the territory. You know? That's a different conversation. The old guns is a different conversation. But the fact that he continues, the fact that the parents, again, the level of density, not destiny, the level of density to continue communicating with this person. Forget the legal system. Maybe the legal system failed you. The legal system fails us all the time in this country. You, as a parent, your responsibility. You didn't need to be dependent on the legal system to keep him away. So they continue this guy, they allow this guy to continue having access to Jan, and they themselves continue to have access to Jan. I don't know, my brain just can't, the horror involved in such a situation, like my brain is still having a hard time processing that, to be honest with you. So again, he takes her the second time around. Anyway, this time around, she's taken for about 4 months. And by this time, again, because I get this, Jan was manipulated. And Jan was groomed. She believed everything this guy said. She was a child. I don't place blame on Jan. Jan is now, I think, at this time when she's kidnapped again, 14 years old, and she's obsessed now with this guy. She willingly leaves with Bridgetold. She willingly leaves with Bridgetold. Still a kidnapping, okay? Not because she left willingly. There's no excuse in this shit here. She willingly leaves with Bridgetold. She's kidnapped the second time around. Taken to Pasadena. Enrolled in the Catholic Church, as I just mentioned. The Catholic schools, I just mentioned, okay? In the Catholic convent. Catholic girls' school. Wasn't she Christian before? Church of Latter-day Saints, I'm pretty sure they're Christians. He poses as her father, again, and this I understand a little bit, the level of documentation that was, what constituted how you proved that you were somebody's parent is probably different now than it was then. And, you know, technology has certainly helped with that as well. But that's insane. Anyway, she's taken for 4 months. 4 months. And in these 4 months, as she's taken, continuing to have communication with the mother, continuing to have communication with the father, taunting them. Ah, God. It's just my brain. Just can't process this sometimes. Thankfully, the investigation into her second appearance was more intensive. Okay, thank you, FBI. The FBI involved, or the reason why it was more intensive was because of the interstate nature of the crime. Okay, and Jan was eventually discovered and located by authorities at the school in Pasadena. Thank the Jesus, thank the universe. And Birchtold was again arrested for the kidnapping. Now, the second time he was arrested, he faced more serious charges than the first time around. Congratulations, American legal system. The specifics, unfortunately, of the proceedings and the exact sentence that was given to him for the kidnapping are not as well documented, unfortunately. If you are out there listening and you are inclined to do a little bit of research about this and you find anything interesting that I may have missed, let me know. I would love to know what his sentence was, where it was carried out. It's just something I couldn't find. He did, in fact, face legal consequences the second time around, but certainly since the bar was so low the first time around that I just don't know. You know, 45 days for the first kidnapping, 45 days for only kidnapping, did not include any charges of, you know, taking a child across the border, trafficking a child. Wouldn't that be a child trafficking charge? Rape of a child. It's just fucking insane, though, the horror that this girl had to fucking survive. So obviously, as you can imagine, a tremendous amount of horrific situations that would be psychological trauma, right? So the second abduction added to the psychological trauma of the first one, as you can imagine. Even though she was brainwashed and manipulated into thinking that she was in love with this guy, there were going to be psychological situations, psychological scarring and trauma that you can only imagine was expected after what she had experienced. It also thankfully led to greater scrutiny and attention on the case. Of course, this had, you know, the incidents joining the family dynamics with the Grobergs grappling with the realization of their misjudgment and the extent of Birchlow's manipulation. Thank God, you realized it. Because they had other children. Can you imagine? The broader implications, okay? The broader implications, not just in terms of the family or the horror that they suffered, but the illogical shit in this fucking horror story to me is the second kidnapping really highlighted the failures in the system, right? Particularly in terms of protecting Jan. In terms of protecting Jan after the first incident, as I just mentioned, why was nothing done? Why was there no restraining order? Why was Birch still allowed to still live in the area? Why was he still allowed to lurk and do it again, you know, after the first incident is ridiculous. Thankfully, the changes in awareness and law enforcement at law changes in awareness and law enforcement techniques. Now, this case contributed to a growing awareness of child abduction, the tactics of the predators, and the need for more stringent and protective measures and law enforcement responses in such cases. So thankfully, it starts to get positive. And you're going to see this in a documentary. But in 2005, Birchtold was again facing charges or possible new charges related to his continued harassment and inappropriate behavior. Thankfully, you never say something like this. I'm not one to say, thank God this guy died. But he committed suicide. And I know this guy was, his brother's also featured in the TV show or in the documentary, but this horror story, I'm sorry. It's just too much for me. So he killed himself, and he killed himself because there were eventually potentially going to be new charges filed against him. And, you know, unfortunately for his family, because you got to feel bad for somebody that goes through a situation like that, but he never actually faced any legal consequences for his actions because any potential legal action or potential further legal proceedings against him were effectively terminated at that point. Now, the case of Robert Birchtold and Jan Brogberg has, you know, highlighted or is highlighted as an example of, as I just said, the failures in the criminal justice system in the 70s, you know, to adequately protect a child, to adequately protect a victim from manipulative and predatory behavior. The leniency that this guy got still baffles me. You know, the leniency in his sentencing, especially after the first abduction, the fact that he was only charged for the kidnapping is insane. It's often cited, thankfully, as, you know, a shocking oversight and a failure of justice. And I don't say thankfully in the sense that, well, you got away. I say that in the sense that, you know, we're aware of it, and thankfully all four of you that are watching this are now more aware of this, and spreading awareness is what we're about. And so the case has, in fact, contributed to broader discussions, such as this one, about how the legal system handles child cases of, you know, abduction of child cases, child kidnapping, sexual abuse, particularly involving perpetrators known to the victim's family. And I had to say this. I was so angry when I saw it. It's a horror story in the worst senses, and they're tough to swallow because they're real. This should happen, right? Most of the stuff that we watch around here is, you know, fake story. And I always said my personal type of horror is Catholic Church horror and demonic possession horror because it's comical. This is not comical. This is legitimately real life fucking horror, and I think that's going to be it for this one. If you're still here, thank you so much for listening. I really recommend this. I endorse this. Go watch this. Again, this is called Abducted in Plain Sight. If you're still here listening to us, thank you so much for joining us on another episode of Rick's horror movie review show, a horror documentary review in this episode. Please follow us on our socials and tell me what you think about us, and give us a recommendation at Rick's Horror on Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, and I forgot the other one, on the YouTubes. All right. We'll catch you again with another exciting episode where we're probably going to do something a little lighter than this one. You know, the real life horror takes a toll on you, and sometimes you just need a little bit something else to deal with the real horror that happens sometimes.
Stop calling it real life horror. It's true crime.
It's real life horror right here on Rick's Horror Movie Review Show.